Please check out Unspoiled Podcast's sponsor for this episode, Mongoose Dog Designs. Mongoose Dog Designs is where fiber art and your geeky imagination come together. Come check out our hand-crocheted Nintendo, Pokemon, and Lovecraft characters, or order a custom item to rep your favorite fandom from Harry Potter to Doctor Who. With an array of ideas and a willingness to bring what you want to life, Mongoose Dog Designs is here to make it happen. We even make wearable items like wristbands and hats. Use offer code UNSPOILED and Mongoose Dog Designs will donate 20% of your order to the Unspoiled Podcast Network to help support the show find a bigger audience. You can find them at facebook.com/mongoosedogdesigns or etsy.com/shop/mongoosedogdesigns. Thank you so much, and on with the show.
This is an Unspoiled Network podcast.
This is Unspoiled, covering Doctor Who, Season 1, Episode 1, kind of, Rose. In this episode, lovely to meet you, Rose. Run for your life. Welcome to Unspoiled. Welcome to the show, everybody. I'm Natasha.
And I'm Jaime.
And this is the first episode of Doctor Who, guys.
Fantastic.
It's the beginning of a new era.
I'm so excited.
So, full disclosure, I have watched this episode and I believe the next episode before.
Okay.
But it has been at least, at this point, probably like 8 years. And upon rewatch, I remembered about 15% to 10% of what actually happened. So it was pretty much like watching it for the first time, despite having seen it already.
I have a question up top before we start discussing anything.
Okay.
How much do you know about Doctor Who? Because things are out there.
Yes. I knew that there was a blue box that time traveled and place traveled. I knew that the doctor can die and then reanimate suggests it's the same body, regenerate as another body. I knew that there is a companion and that person changes all the time. And I know that there are things called, what are they called? Weeping angels that are scary to people.
Okay.
I've heard about that, and I have also heard of the little, the word I can remember is actually from Community, the Blorgons. I know that is not actually what they're called. Daleks. That's the one, right? I know the name of them, and that they, like, shoot laser beams. And that's about what I've got.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, I would imagine because you weren't, like, holding this off on purpose to record, that because spoilers are everywhere about it, it's really hard. I mean, I went into it knowing some of those things, not about the Weeping Angels, but I knew that there was something called Daleks. They look like pepper pots.
Yes.
Little trash cans with lasers. And that there was a doctor who had different bodies at different times. And I was like, I don't know. I saw it on PBS when I was a kid. It was super cheesy. I'm going to skip it. And then all my friends were like, no, no. You will love it. Just give it a try. So I did. And they were right.
Yeah, I feel like because the first time I watched this episode, I just think I came into it with a wrong headspace. Like, I think I thought it was going to be a little bit more... I hate to use the word gritty, but I'm gonna use it. I just thought it was gonna be a little more like hardcore, and I didn't really understand like the tone of it is meant to be rather campy in a lot of ways, and it's like a little bit Buffy-esque in that way.
Yeah, where it's a family show.
Yeah, So I think that the first time I watched this episode, I really hated it. I hated it so much. And there were so many people, because of the podcast, like, are you ever going to do Doctor Who? And I was like, I don't want to do that to you guys. You're just going to hate me. But rewatching it and knowing where to, like, how to come into it, I really liked it this time. Like, it was a complete turnaround. So I'm hoping that, like, just kind of understanding that better will change how I feel about everything.
Did your impression of Billy Piper from Penny Dreadful help with that at all?
To be honest, she was so wasted in Penny Dreadful that I feel like I tried not to let it affect it, because I'd just be filled with such resentment and disappointment and rage that wouldn't be actually be a good thing for anybody. So. Okay. No, I think I tried to actively hold that off.
Okay, because I know that you thought she was really great on that. Yeah. I agree that she was wasted, but she was great. So a lot of people, my former roommate included, just thought she was a terrible actress. Huh. And I never agreed with that, so.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting, because now that you say that, I think I remember thinking that when I watched this episode, too, that I specifically didn't like her. And for whatever reason this time around, I had no problem with her at all. I don't know if maybe it's because the campiness, like, she has a specific tone to the way that she's acting, and that I just didn't fully appreciate what that meant. But, yeah, I actually feel like I've done like a total 180 from my opinions on this the first time.
Well, that is great. And yeah. I think people are going to be happy to hear it.
Hopefully, fingers crossed, it sustains itself. okay. Is there any other question? Do you want to get into the plot?
Yeah, let's get into the plot.
All right. So Rose is heading out to work. She works at a place that looks rather like the Top Shop or someplace like that. And is allowed to work in jeans and a hoodie, which is unheard of, madam. This is not American Eagle. I don't know, maybe it is. English Eagle.
English Swan.
They would do that, wouldn't they? English Griffin. And we see just a montage of her working, meeting her boyfriend out for lunch, who is played by Mickey Smith. And I know his name is Mickey Smith. He's played by Noel Clark. What has he been in? Do you know?
The only other thing I've seen him in is Star Trek Into Darkness. And I was excited because I knew him from Doctor Who.
I don't think I even saw Into Darkness, actually.
That's the one with Benedict Cumberbatch.
Yeah, I guess I did see that a really long time ago.
Yeah, but otherwise, I don't know offhand.
Ringing a bell for me, and I don't know what I'm going to look up his deal here.
He's very easy on the eyes.
Yeah, he's got a really unusual look. But so it says Brotherhood, Bulletproof, Star Trek, Into Darkness, viewed 35 more. This guy is prolific. All right. All of this are like, these are really low budget, like nothing, so that I have not seen. Yeah, maybe it is just Star Trek. Maybe that's all I recognize him from.
He guessed it on like Black Mirror or something. I don't know.
Maybe.
He does a lot of British stuff.
Yeah, that's all it seems like it is. Well, in any case, I have to admit that this time around, I like grew to like him really quickly. And so when it seemed like something had happened to him, I was just like unexpectedly like, oh, well, that's not fair. And then he's fine. But then she ditches him, which I was like, well, shit, that's harsh, lady. It seemed like you liked him, I thought. But I guess not that much. But we'll get there. I'm just registering my surprise. So she's about to leave the building and at the end of the day after finishing her shift. And the security guy stops her with an baggie with money and stuff in it.
I think it's supposed to be lottery winnings. That's what the recap I found said. But they never say that in the show. So I don't know where that came from.
Well, she yells. She's like, Wilson, I've got the lottery money, but I don't understand what that means. And like, why is the security guy giving her lottery money? Like, I don't understand what?
I don't know. Maybe our British listeners can weigh in. Is this something other than what we think of as a lottery?
Yeah. I don't know if maybe like the store was supposed to have been doing some kind of promotion or something, like maybe. A raffle.
I mean, he's the chief electrician, the guy she's bringing it to.
Right. And doesn't that seem also weird? Why is he the guy who gets it?
Maybe it's one of those, like, the employees all put in money for the lottery for tickets.
Oh, maybe. Okay. That would make sense. All right. Yeah, that makes sense. I'll go with that. So she goes downstairs and Wilson is nowhere to be found. And she can hear somebody moving around and goes to investigate. And there is a creepy moving dummy, which is actually pretty effective. It's very creepy. Yeah. He has no face. I disliked it. And they begin to chase her and she is running away from them as they get more and more aggressive and more like active. And she's in the middle of like she's pinned between them and the wall. And one of them is clearly about to like seriously go after her when a hand grips hers and there's a man here and he's like, run. And she's like, good idea. And then the dummy, slices off a pipe and I guess it's a gas line. Is that what leads to the explosion later?
Well, the doctor has a bomb.
Oh, right. Right. So whatever it is, it's just like steam then, I guess. And they manage to get onto the elevator just as one of the dummies shoves his arm in there, fugitive style, and he yanks it off. And Fugitive style, indeed. For some reason, she brings it home with her, which I found strange. I guess? Like, I don't know, maybe she thought that, like, I could go to work in the morning and, like, put it back.
But I don't think she thought that because the building blew up.
Well, I mean, the building... Yeah, you're right. You're right.
Are you ever, like, in shock and you just are like, what the fuck just happened? And you don't think about what's in your hands and you get somewhere and you're like, why do I have this? That's how I took it. That she was like, why do I have this arm? Tossed it.
Okay. Yeah, but I have never done that, but I think that's because I'm lucky enough to not have, like, really experienced trauma in that way, so.
I haven't either. I base a lot of things on television.
That's fair.
Also, it needed to be there so the doctor could come back.
Yes, that's true. There's something really fun about these, like, dummies that they move, but their faces still don't move.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I kind of like that design choice because it would have been easy to kind of make them animate, like, completely.
Mm-hmm.
But instead, you know what this reminded me of? Do you remember that, Are You Afraid of the Dark episode where she's stuck in the mall after dark?
I never saw that show. Sorry. Was that a Nickelodeon thing in the 90s?
Yes!
All right.
Dare you even phrase it that way so dismissively, ma'am?
No, I think it's because I was in high school when all of those shows got really popular on Nickelodeon, and I was in that phase of, like, I am not watching Nickelodeon. I'm a teenager. I'm too old for this. And I wasn't, but I thought I was. I didn't watch the Disney Channel anymore either.
High school's giving you airs and graces.
You know how it is to be 15 and think you're an adult.
I'm just like thinking though, because when I watched it, I was much younger than that. I'm looking up to see like when it came out. Yeah, first episode date, October 31st, 1990. It came out on Halloween in 1990. Is that so great?
You know, I was pretty young then. I don't know why I didn't watch it then. I have no idea.
Final episode date, June 11th, 2000.
Wow.
Yeah.
Was it like goosebumps? Was it that kind of thing?
It's similar. Yeah, it's really like there were a couple episodes that were very creepy in their very specific way. And most of it was not scary, even to somebody like me, who is the biggest coward
It's funny because you love spooky things.
I love spooky things, and I also cannot handle them at all. I was trying to get myself in the mood for doing the Unspookled episodes for patrons coming up, and I was listening to my own podcast that I did last year and had to turn it off because I was flipping out.
I've literally lived in haunted houses, so it takes a lot to actually legitimately scare me.
Dislike. It's there's one in particular that I think people might remember if I mentioned the one about the clown, and that one always gets me. And then there is a silly witch one that's hilarious. But yeah, there's like 10 seasons I'm checking. I didn't realize that it was like, that there were, because season one has 7 episodes. I may have to buy these and watch them all October long. Yeah, it's about 7 episodes per season, it looks like.
Huh.
And this is probably going to be the new thing that I do every year around this time. And everyone's going to really hate it. But you know what? He'll be fine. But yeah, anyway, there's an episode where this girl, it's, you know, you're not sure if it's a dream or if it's really happening, but she's in a mall and there's like dummies that come alive and the whole place turns into a giant pinball machine and the escalators are like moving the balls around and they're like thundering after her. It's a really fun idea and it creeped me out so bad as a kid.
That should totally be something in an amusement park.
Being stuck in a giant pinball machine?
Yes.
Yeah, I see that. Kind of an Indiana Jones moment with it rolling after you.
Yeah.
And you have to dive out of the way.
All right, don't steal this idea.
We will accept deposit of $700,000 for the idea. Please and thank you. So yeah, she's hanging out with him in the elevator and he's such a dick.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I really enjoy him. I have to mention that Christopher Eccleston is fantastic.
Fantastic.
He is very sexy also.
Really?
Yeah, I find him very attractive. Like, he just has this sort of confidence about him that really irritates me, and I like it. And
he almost made me snort.
And I think part of my attraction to him is because the first thing I ever saw him in was Elizabeth.
Okay.
Have you seen that movie?
Yes.
You remember how he plays the evil duke?
Yes.
Remember how the evil duke is banging that girl and he has a really nice butt?
No.
Yeah.
It's been a while since I watched it. I should go back.
And you know, that's probably not his butt. I bet it's not. But it was a pretty good scene. And he's like real aggressive with her in this like huge canopy bed and just has a really nice ass. And I think that just left an impression on me. And so every time I saw him after that, I was like, ooh, what's up, Duke? So that's what's going on there.
I didn't know everybody should watch Elizabeth. Until this. I mean, I'd seen Elizabeth before I watched Doctor Who, but I didn't remember him from it at the time. So
okay.
I really, this was my introduction to Christopher Eccleston.
Yeah, he's a bad guy in that. Bad man.
He does come off as really dismissive of Rose in the elevator.
Yeah.
But but he's also impressed with her. Because she's saying students, and he's like, why students? And she's like, well, you would have to get, you know, people like that together to organize something like this. And he's like, okay.
Yes, well done. They're not students. Thanks, guy. Also, she's asking where Wilson is still. And he says, who's that? She says, chief electrician. And he says, oh, Wilson's dead. What tact?
Well, he's old, been living for a long time, and
listen, Jamie, you can't keep making the mistakes for the excuses for his mistakes that we make for all old white men. Okay,
I'm excusing the doctor specifically for how this is his 9th version. He's lived. We don't know yet how many years.
That's true.
So maybe death is just different to him.
Well, maybe he should learn some goddamn empathy, sir. Maybe you should take some classes or something. I don't know. Watch Field of Dreams. Apparently that's the tearjerker for guys. Right?
Never seen it. But sure. That's what I hear.
Anyway, so yeah. He is explaining to her, like, oh yeah, they're made of plastic, but they're alive. They're being controlled by a relay device on the roof, which would be a problem if I didn't have this. Which I really felt like it was a super blunt force way to deal with the problem.
Mm-hmm.
Like, rather than just go deal with the relay device, he just blows up the entire building?
Yeah.
That seems unnecessary, but okay.
It's a little maybe overkill.
Yeah, you know, in the very literal way as well as the figurative way. But yeah, so she runs off and she's like trying to stroll casually down the street holding a mannequin arm, as you do, when all of a sudden there is a bang and the building explodes. And when she gets home, her mother is just like, is everything okay? What happened to you?
You better get compensation.
This, her mom is really something.
Yes.
Here goes a part of this that I didn't remember in the slightest. I had no memory of her mother being like this, and it's pretty fun. Like, she's on the phone with her friend and talks about how she looks like she's aged so much from the shock that her skin is like an old Bible. Which is just such a specific way to, like, to... I don't know. That imagery is really something.
I like how she says sweetheart. Sweetheart. Love it.
Sweetheart.
I like Jackie.
Yeah, I really like her too, despite her being like really annoying.
She's super obnoxious. I like her.
When she would have thought that I was her daughter. So she's on the couch just like chilling out and recovering as they have the news on. And her boyfriend comes by and it's just like, hey, is everything cool? Because I've been calling your phone and you have not been answering and you could have been dead. How about you just tell me what's happening? And her mom is trying to get her to demand compensation for almost being killed and also to take interviews with the news.
Which the doctor told her before he dismissed her not to talk to anybody or people could get killed.
Right. Which, I kind of want her to do it anyway, because he seemed like a real asshole. So, just go ahead and do what you want, lady. So, she winds up sending off her boyfriend because he wants to, he's pretending that it's because he is, cares so much about her that he wants to take her out to the pub. And she's like, yeah, there's definitely a game on, isn't there? And he's like, well, now that you mention it.
Could catch the last 5 minutes.
Yeah. So he takes the mannequin arm with him and tosses it outside in the dumpster, which apparently is ineffective because that shit just comes crawling back like thing. We don't actually see it do that, but we find out that the cat flap is open. How did it do that?
Well, it pushed the nails out.
Okay.
The only, like, interesting little piece of trivia that I wanted to share about this was that they wanted a cat flap and for the doctor to stick his head through it. And when the cat flap arrived, it was way too small.
I think that if he stuck his head through it, it wouldn't have been in character somehow. I like that he doesn't. Because yeah. I feel like he takes himself pretty seriously. And that would be such a goofy thing for him to do. And, like, don't get me wrong, I have no doubt there are goofy things ahead.
Mm-hmm.
But there was something about, like, there's a vibe that he's, like, trying to maintain a sort of impressive mystique with her at this point still.
Mm-hmm.
And doing that, I feel like, is a little much. But, yeah, that is a very small cat flap. Most people's heads aren't going to fit through that.
I guess I've only ever seen dog doors. Because when I saw it, I was like, that is really small.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, to keep freaking... stray dogs from coming in. Maybe raccoons, though. You'd have a raccoon problem. I could see that happening.
I have seen some fat ass raccoons, so maybe not. They get stuck, wedged like Winnie the Pooh.
There is that Have you seen that video of the one that's coming out of the doghouse outside?
No.
I'll have to send it to you. It's all you can see is the raccoon's head and somebody puts a bowl of food down outside and this raccoon hoists itself and you can see its head and its little paws and you're like, oh my God, how cute. And then all of a sudden it's like,
oh yes.
And it's like gotta be 50 pounds, 40 pounds. The fact that it could move was frankly shocking to
it
me.
Actually made me really sad.
It was a little sad, yeah.
That raccoon is way too fat. It needs to get on the treadmill or in a water treadmill because it's too fat. Its poor little legs are going to crush on
give
the
out. Weight. Yeah. I think that it was that journey from its doghouse to the food bowl is like the one bit of movement that it gets every day. And then it retires Jabba the Hutt-like back to its doghouse where there's probably some tiny animal that keeps him company and cracks jokes.
A chipmunk.
There you go. I like this. We got to set this up. We need to do an Animals Star Wars reboot.
Challenge accepted. Let's get Krista to draw it.
So, oh my God. Yeah, she would do this. She'd be all on board with this. Yep. So she opens the cat flap, noticing that the nails are out. He's right there, and I guess she assumes that the cat flap is open because of him, because he's, banging on it, and lets him in, and it tells her mother that it's part of the inquiry. And her mother sees him and reacts much the way I would also react if Christopher Eccleston were standing in my living room in a black leather jacket with his neck.
Specifically.
I like that neck, man. I'm a sucker for necks. The ears? Yeah, that's fair. The ears are a little bit much.
I can't help how his ears are.
It's I'm a fan of the neck, and I feel like the ears are balanced by the thickness of it.
Just going places I was not expecting.
So she's like, oh, I'm in my bathrobe. Yes, you are. And there's a strange man in my bedroom. Yes, there is. Well, anything could happen. No. And then he just walks away. Oh, that's crushing.
Her face, she made a little scrunch oh.
Oh, well, blah. Yeah, it was pretty good. So he is wandering around in her living room, and he says something about, look at the ears himself in the mirror.
Mm-hmm.
But when she talks to Clive later, it seems like he's been in this body for, a while now. So is he surprised at this?
Well,
is it supposed to be that, he is just seeing himself in the mirror for the first time? He's been running around London. That place is, 80% mirrors and glass.
The thing about the doctor is he can travel in time. So the stuff that Clive has could have happened after what's happening now. And then, in the doctor's timeline.
Oh, okay.
But in our timeline, it's our history.
Yeah.
But for him,
okay.
He could go tomorrow to JFK's assassination.
Nevertheless, he was in a giant department store last night. I feel
he
should have
spotted
his ears.
He was a little preoccupied. it is sort of an indication that he regenerated not too long ago, and maybe this is the first time he's gotten a good look at himself.
Yeah, that's fair. So he's in the middle of talking while she's making them both some cups of tea and thinks that he hears a cat. And she's in the middle of talking about how, no, we don't have cats. It was just... we have the cat flap because we had one, and she comes into the living room, and the friggin' hand is strangling him, but she just thinks that it's him doing the same bullshit that her boyfriend did when he grabbed the hand earlier, and that he's, dicking around, and he finally gets it off him, and it, pauses in midair, and then flips around and comes after her, and lands right on her face like this is alien.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't want to know what that hand does if it gets to stay on her face. And he winds up using his little doodad on it to stop it moving.
Sonic screwdriver.
There you go. That thing. It doesn't look like a screwdriver.
But it
looks like
it opens like one of those things up.
It looks like the pen light you use to distract cats with. You know?
Yeah.
But blue.
Yeah.
But yeah, he is very excited because this is the thing that he was tracking, and he thinks that he can use this chunk of this this dummy to track back where all of this is coming from. It turns out later that it did not work, but good effort. And he leaves, and she follows him outside and is questioning him about everything, and basically threatens to tell the cops all that she knows if he doesn't explain things. And he really doesn't make a huge effort here. He's just basically, like, tells her some bullshit about how he can feel the earth spin, and then he's like, and that's who I am. And I'm like, that was not an answer, sir. Come on. You gotta give her something.
I think he's trying to keep her at a distance.
Well, it's working, because I would not want to continue speaking to him either.
But she's intrigued, nonetheless.
It's baffling. This is like... Right here, I feel like I if I were being really uncharitable, and I were her in this moment, I would think that he was like some sort of weird... I would think that he was maybe LARPing. You know? None of this was real. He was doing some strange shit to, like, try and impress me or impress somebody. And, you know, then talking poetry about the earth spinning. And then being like, well, maybe you can come find me later, sweetheart. And walking off while trying to maintain his mystique. But... You know, I'm also pretty impatient with men these days, so that's probably part of it.
And she's young and impressionable.
Evidently.
I think she's only supposed to be like 19 or 20.
Yeah. Oh man, can we talk about them wide leg jeans? You remember those?
Yes.
They're going to start making a comeback soon.
Well, right now it's acid wash jeans, so we have a little while before we get the good flares again.
Yeah, we've had skinny jeans for too long at this point now. It's been about, what, 5 years?
Maybe longer. 4 years? I love skinny jeans.
I'm a fan of them now that they are all spandex.
Mm-hmm.
I can't imagine what it must have been like when skinny jeans were in fashion when denim was just cotton. Like, that's insane. What were we doing to ourselves?
Suffering for fashion like we always do.
Oh my God. I remember my mom telling me that she had a pair of jeans that were so tight that she wound up getting a boil on her butt from the friction. Yeah.
My mom That's used to rough. Tell me about how she had to use like pliers to pull up the zipper because hers were so tight. She'd have to lay on the bed and have pliers to pull up the zipper.
Good God in heaven. How do you sit? You can't sit, right?
You can't sit.
Or if you do sit, you just have to like accept the fact that you are going to have a perfect molded copy of your jeans embedded in your skin for the hour after you remove those jeans.
It was the 70s. They were just, I don't know, dancing? What did people do in the 70s? Just
dancing and taking Quaaludes.
Yeah.
And just chilling out.
Who cares how uncomfortable you are if you're on Quaaludes?
Oh my God. This is the moment where he walks away and gets in the TARDIS, the police box, for the first time. And she hears it as she's walking around the corner and turns around and runs back and it is gone. Da-da-da-da! I will say, too, when it made the noise, I knew what the noise was somehow.
Mm.
Like, I must have heard it on other fandom stuff or... Somehow I had heard this noise before and knew what to associate it with, but I don't remember how. So once it started, I was like, oh, the TARDIS sound. And then I was like, wait, how do I know that? Maybe it's just from this, but I don't think I remembered that from actually watching this episode because I remembered so little.
I feel like it's one of those things that's just in the general pop culture consciousness.
Yeah, maybe. It's like knowing the Jaws theme.
Yeah.
So she goes to her boyfriend's place to use his computer and Googles doctor. Girl.
Oh, Rose.
This is like a real Bella Swan moment. I typed it into my favorite search engine.
And it's not even Google. It's searchwise.net.
It's not even a .com, guys. It's not even a .com search engine. It's a .net. Don't trust a .net search engine. Good Lord. So yeah, then she's like, doctor, living plastic. And then doctor, blue box. And the top result, doctor who? Have you seen this man? Contact Clive. And the next scene is her going over to Clive's place with her boyfriend in their bright yellow bug. And he is very concerned that this guy is a psycho killer. And the fact that she knows the dude has kids and a wife, but only because that dude told her so, does not really comfort him in any way. So he's sitting and watching the outside of the house as if he's going to, like, bust out and, like, break a window and go in there if there's anything, like, amiss. And sits there waiting for her the whole time, and that's when some shenanigans happen.
Mm-hmm.
This was delightful.
I'm glad you found it delightful.
This, okay, so first of all, it's a garbage can. Just seems to, like, kind of turn and look at him a little bit, like, huh, what are you doing? And it keeps wiggling towards him. And rather than just stay in the car, which I'm pretty sure I would do, because once again, I'm a huge coward, he gets out of the car and goes to examine it to figure out what the hell could be moving it. I think he assumes there's an animal or something pushing it, but when he looks around the outside, there's nothing there. And so he lifts the lid, and there's nothing inside it either. And he's about to pull away, but his hands are stuck. And it's like, if I had been going to theorize what was going to happen here, I feel like I should have seen this coming, but I would not have thought this. Because basically he's stuck to it to such a point that he can't walk away. He like gets a few feet back and then keeps being yanked back like he's on a rubber band. And finally, it yanks him so hard that he gets pulled right off his feet and the lid of the can opens and he goes inside and it shuts and it burps.
Yep.
But then when she's done, he's in the car, which was the most unnerving thing.
And he's got that smile.
And they've done his makeup so that he looks creepy and, like, plasticky.
Yep.
Ugh. That was some good makeup, though. That's some Instagram-worthy makeup right there. And meanwhile, she's talking to Clive, who's charming. But understandably, everybody thinks he is nuts.
Mm-hmm.
They think she's nuts, too, because she's coming to talk to him. Association.
And his wife is like, she's a she. Mm-hmm. Like, Rose is the first woman to come by and be like, yeah, I want to hear about this doctor nonsense.
Yeah, I'm curious about that. Why is it that no ladies are interested in this? I feel like that's a pretty, like, women buy into conspiracy theories just as much.
Do they?
I feel like they do.
They certainly buy into some.
Are you referencing something specific? I feel like you're referencing something specific.
I am, but I don't want to have a bunch of hate mail, so.
Oh. It's fine. You won't get it. It'll just come to me.
It's just the whole anti-vax thing.
Oh, God. Yeah.
Yeah.
Guys, don't buy Kat Von D's products, okay? Just saying. That's Instagram not worthy makeup. So he's showing her the photos of the doctor in all of these different places, which I have to admit some delight at the idea that he like purposely lets himself get photographed. Like, I want the doctor to be a bit of a ham.
Mm-hmm.
And be like, oh, you know, some shit's about to go down here. Hold on, get right there. There's a camera there because this is going to be in history books. I'm super excited about it. I feel like that would be a fun thing to sort of keep track of, is how many books you were in and what you were cameoing for, and, you know, just kind of, I don't know. I feel like that would be something that a vain person like myself would enjoy keeping records of. But in any case, he's showing her all these pictures, and her assumption, of course, is that, not that this is a man who is, like, you know, immortal, as this guy is theorizing, but that it's his father, and that he just bears a striking resemblance to his dad. And when she finally, like, nails it down with this guy that he thinks the doctor is an alien, it cuts right from that moment to her, like, going outside and telling her boyfriend that, yeah, you're right, he's nuts. I think he's the same man. I think he's immortal. I think he's an alien from another world. And, yeah, it's a lot to say to somebody.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, I don't feel like there's a better way to phrase that.
He's not entirely wrong.
I mean, apparently not. And it comes down to when you're trying to explain that you think somebody's not from this planet, and that they have powers, and that they have lived a long time, how do you say that without sounding just like this guy? It's just, you can't.
Yeah.
You're gonna sound nuts. So, yeah, she goes back to the car, and he's sitting there with his creepy skin. And he has that, like, wig that makes his, like, hairline really sharp.
Yeah, severe.
Yeah. Oh, man. He's freaking me out. I'm watching it right now. I have it on, like, playing in front of me, and I hate it.
He's really funny in these scenes.
Yeah.
Pizza. Pizza. Pizza.
I can't help but wonder at the actor, because he has to sit across from her without blinking, with that smile on his face the entire time. His face must have gotten so sore.
Yeah.
Take after take after take, just holding that expression the whole time.
I don't know how she didn't laugh. I wonder how many times they had to cut because she laughed at him.
Oh my god. This is probably, like, there's got to be people who cosplay him as a mannequin, right?
I haven't seen any, but I'm going to have to look now.
Really, like, easy but distinctive cosplay. Yeah, oh, I won't look. I won't check. And for some reason, like, despite the fact that he's acting like a complete fucking freak, she doesn't seem to, like, notice.
Well, she does when he's like, sweetheart, baby, sugar, sweetheart. Oh, my
God. He starts to literally malfunction.
She's like, what's the matter with you?
Yeah. Why are you doing that? As they sit in, like, the fanciest pizza place I've ever seen, yeah, by the way.
With champagne.
Yeah. What? It's, it looks like Xanadu in there.
I don't know. British, it's a whole different place.
Yeah.
We're way more cash here.
Super cash. We ordered champagne? We didn't order champagne. Don't you want your champagne? No, that's not our champagne. That's not. And he's like, where's the doctor? What do you know? What is. And she's like, I don't know what you're talking about. And why are you acting so weird? And finally, he sits back and looks up as this guy keeps insisting that they have some champagne. And it's the doctor who decides to, for some reason, use the champagne as a weapon. It pops its cork into his head, which he then, like, catches in this weird plastic bendy cup of a head and spits it out. And then he gets up and turns his hand into the paddles that you use to mix McFlurries. But giant.
Or giant, like, pizza paddles.
Yeah, what are they called? Peels. Pizza peel.
Yeah.
Weird choice. Like, you could be a fork. You could be a knife. But no, you choose to just be this weird square paddle thing, which doesn't seem super effective.
How smart is plastic?
Yeah, that's true. I, like, don't know exactly how much self-motivation he has, or how much he's being controlled, or, you know, if he's just got like the one mission and he's just in, programmed to do that in some way. But the doctor yanks his head off, and then they just run and leave this headless body thrashing around behind them. And that just seems really irresponsible.
Rose was smart enough to pull the fire alarm and tell everybody to get out.
Yeah, it's just like, you've worked in kitchens. Nobody in the kitchen's listening to a customer who pulled the fire alarm. Am I wrong? Like, you're just going to be like, what did this bitch do? Oh my God, we don't have time for this. And you would totally not move. Am I wrong?
Probably not. Because you're back at where the fire is. So generally,
yeah,
you can pretty much expect there's like, not a fire.
Yeah. If you're expecting anybody to pull a fire alarm and mean it, it's going to be somebody in the kitchen. But in any case, he goes into the police box and tells her to come in too, but she does not believe that there will be any safety to be had here and doesn't listen to him and is trying to get out through this like side gate thing. And finally, as it looks like Dummy Man is really going to beat his way right through the metal doors, she's like, all right, fine. And goes in and like is very startled and leaves right away again. Until she realizes she really doesn't have a choice and goes back in. So what she was startled by is the fact that it is quite roomy inside and obviously full of alien technology.
Mm-hmm.
And,
when she first ran out, she walked around it because she couldn't believe like it's so big inside. So she walked around it to see how big it was on the outside.
Right.
It was normal sized.
I like you say normal sized. Like,
I mean, a police box.
Well, you know about
size.
The size of the average police box, which I'm just like, I don't know how. Yes, all right.
It's kind of the size of a phone booth. Remember those?
Phone booths. I don't honestly. Like, the US didn't really have phone booths the same way that the UK had phone booths. We had, like, those metal half boxes that hung up somewhere.
Yeah, in big cities, like in New York, they used to have phone booths at some time, but I think maybe they changed it because people were probably sleeping in them.
Peeing in them.
And peeing in them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, the first time I visited London, the phone booths were plastered with ads for sex workers on the inside. Like, floor to ceiling. Photos and phone numbers of women in various states of undress, which scandalized me as a 12-year-old girl trying to make a phone call to her mommy. but then when I visited again years later, all that was gone. So apparently they really cleaned that up. But it was a lot. So she has a little moment here as she's like, is this alien? And he's like, yep. And she starts to cry. And he says, culture shock. To which she has to be like, no, did they kill my boyfriend? And I'm like, yeah, dude, come on. That, again, he's not very empathetic. And his response is literally, oh, I didn't really think of that. You know what? Even if you didn't think of that, you don't say out loud that you didn't really think of that.
Yeah.
Just keep that shit to yourself.
It's as if he has not been around people in a long time.
Yeah.
Like he doesn't
know
how
to react. It's just straight up
not
occurred to him. So he's got her boyfriend's head, not boyfriend's head, hooked up to something because he's trying to track that signal again. And his head starts to melt away. And it melts before he's able to really zero in on it. So when they go outside, they're closer to whatever's sending this signal that he's trying to trace back. But they're not actually there. He's just in the vicinity. And so he's like, I have no idea where this signal could be coming from. Because whatever they're using to transmit it is enormous and round like a wheel. And where do you hide it in a place like this? And meanwhile, the London Eye is just twirling behind him. in a very obvious manner. And I love that he turns around and is just like, what? As she's standing there going, are you kidding me right now?
How long has the London Eye been there?
I don't know. Let's ask the interwebs. Because it was there when I visited, I'm pretty sure. And I, like I said, was 12.
Okay. So a lot longer than I thought. I don't know why I thought that. Because the bridge that's over there is called Millennium Bridge, right?
Is it?
Yeah. That, like, walking bridge. The one that gets, like, destroyed in Harry Potter.
Oh, okay.
And I think that was built, calling it Millennium Bridge, for the new millennium. Like, around the time of the new millennium. And for some reason in my head, that's when the London Eye was built too, but that can't be right.
You would think that the London Eye website would have information, but it does not seem to.
Well, someone can tell us.
When was London Eye built? 1998.
Oh.
So it must have been, like, brand new when I went. Actually, maybe it wasn't there when I went. Maybe it was only there the second time I went. Yeah, yeah. So, yeah, not too
Did you go on it?
Before. No.
My friends went on it this summer. Said it was terrifying. It's really high.
I would never... I don't think I would ever go on that. Like, there's a big part of me that kind of wants to, but I'm really bad with heights. And it's not only, like, really high up. It's over water. Mm-hmm. Like, it's so close to the water. That just adds a whole other aspect of everything to it. Yeah, I don't think so.
I'd go on it.
I bet you would, you psycho.
I'm not afraid of heights. I'm afraid of falling, but I'm not afraid of heights. I actually like being up high, so I would totally go on it and be nervous, but fine.
I have a weird thing when I'm on some, like, if when I'm positioned somewhere high, I get this uncontrollable urge to fling myself off into space.
That is fucked up.
It is incredibly fucked up. And it's not even like, I want to kill myself. It's more just like, I wonder what that'd be like. What a rush.
Do you ever go to the Grand Canyon?
Yes.
Did you have that urge there?
No, because it's not a straight shot down. Like, unless you're in very specific spots. Usually, it's just an extremely steep, like, cliffside that still fans out towards the ground. Mm-hmm. So if you, like, tried to jump, you'd jump about 5 feet, and then you would just roll the rest of the way, which doesn't sound fun at all.
When I went, there were areas on the out, like the overlooks, that didn't have like the guardrail up. And I found that to be really strange.
Yeah.
And I was 13 and I was like, I could just walk to the edge and my fear of falling got the best of me. And I was like, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to stay here where there's a guardrail just in case I trip. This'll catch me.
I've seen too many true crime shows. That's a perfect opportunity for somebody that you don't know who is stalking you to come up behind you and just shove you. And then yell as you fall to your death that nobody else will ever have you.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's how it goes, right?
Yeah. In
general.
I actually
haven't watched that many true crime shows.
But you know the nature of human men.
Yeah, that's pretty much what it is.
We both human managed to men. Find good ones, and now we can hate all the rest.
He turns around and realizes, and they head for it. Lots of lovely London imagery here. Double-decker buses behind them. Big Ben sitting there.
Yeah, it really made me want to go to London so bad that I turned to Jason and said, can we please go to London? And he was like, yeah, sure. Like, let's go now. But I've never been there. Desperately want to go.
I, like, had a pretty bad time my second time, but I still kind of want to go back. I would like to bring Owen, because he's never been outside of the U.S.
Me neither.
And I feel like London's a real good starter travel city.
Yeah.
You know? What was it that he says about the breast implants?
She says it. He's talking about they're called the nesting consciousness, like Nestle, but not, that it controls all the plastic, and then the plastic will try to take over. And he starts naming things off, and she says breast implants.
Oh my god.
Which I don't think are plastic, are they? Anymore?
Does silicone count?
I don't know.
Because I think, like, there, a lot of them are like a liquid based from plastic.
Hmm.
There are water ones, but those don't look great. Just, you know, my opinion.
I'll have to ask my friend. She just got some recently.
But yeah, I feel...
Can I feel?
Do you think if an alien was going to take over the Earth using plastic that they would be able to control you with your breast implants? Just a question out of
nowhere.
Just easy
access to controlling your whole body, I guess.
I mean, if you think about all of the implants that we have for bodies now, that plastic has got to be, like, way up there.
Yeah.
For joints and all kinds of things, you know? And most cars at this point are built with a ton of plastic as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, if a alien that can control plastic came to the Earth, we would be pretty fucked.
That'd be the end of that.
Yeah.
Yeah, Magneto could hold no candle to Plastico. So they go into the London Eye. There's, like, this maintenance room. And there is, like, a seething mass of liquid hot magma.
It's like molten plastic.
Yeah.
And the doctor can understand it.
Yeah. And he's, like, talking about the proclamations of the Shadow Council something. All of these bylaws.
Mm-hmm.
About why it's okay for him to approach and talk to it. And, you know, it will sort of ensure his safety because they have codes in place. And then Rose sees that Mickey is here and that he's fine. And the doctor's like, oh, yeah, that was possible that they might do that. And he's like, she can't believe that he wouldn't have mentioned that when she's just, like, asking him, do you think they killed my boyfriend? He doesn't even ever actually give her a straight answer to that. It goes straight from, oh yeah, I didn't really think of that, to, oh shit, because the head's melting. So he never answers her, and then at this point, she's like, you could have reassured me that maybe he was fine, and you just didn't. And he's essentially like, yeah, well, you know, I had things to do. So now you see he's fine. Who cares whether I told you or not? He's fine. That's what matters.
It's really a wonder that she wants to travel with him.
I can't understand it.
Maybe she just sees an opportunity for something more exciting than working in a shop in London.
It's his neck.
Maybe it's the ears.
It's the ears. I like that idea. She's into ears. She's got an ear thing.
I mean, Mickey, you can see Mickey's ears too. He's got no hair covering it.
Let me look at Mickey's ears real quick and see how they stand up. Get it?
Or stand out, as it were.
They're all right. They don't really hold a candle, though, in the end. He's got pretty normal ears. And he's got attached lobes like, what's his name, that played Robin. Which always I find distracting.
Chris O'Donnell?
Yeah, Chris O'Donnell's got attached lobes.
I never noticed that.
Yeah. But in any case, I'm sure this is really riveting stuff. So he is talking to this consciousness, and it turns out that he's got, like, a weapon that they sense. I'm trying to watch exactly how this goes.
He's got a vial of what he calls antiplastic, but he said he was only going to use it as a last resort. He wanted to try to talk to them first.
Okay. That's right, because they just, like, he doesn't even have it in his hand or anything. They can just sense that it's on him. I wonder what that, like, all right, well, so he's in the middle of trying to be like, no, 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 I wasn't attacking you. I didn't do anything. And then all of a sudden, this, like, screen shows up. It looks like a screen, unless that's actually his ship. But I don't think so, right? It's just an image of it. I think.
No, the TARDIS is really there.
Oh, it is?
Yeah. Okay. I think they brought it somehow. I don't know. They never really explain how the TARDIS got there.
Yeah, it's like, because it looks so weird, and I'm sure, like, probably for the actual production, it is just an image of it and it's not actually there.
Mm-hmm.
And that's just kind of what I'm seeing here and thinking that they were just using an image to make an example and be like, hey, this is what we're talking about right now. But in any case, there's like a little bit of baggage between him and this consciousness where it seems to be accusing him of not helping when there was a war.
Mm-hmm.
And that it like allowed a bunch of its people to die.
His planet. Its planet.
Its whole planet.
Yeah.
That's rough. And he's like saying that there was nothing that he could do.
Yeah. That he couldn't save any of them.
And he seems really like cut up about this. So apparently he has some empathy for plastic. So that's good to know. Not human beings, but you know, whatever.
He reserves his empathy for alien creatures, which humans would be to him.
Yeah, one would think that he'd translate that a little bit better.
Yeah.
But nevertheless, this results in this consciousness activating the transmitter, and then we get to see all of these people on the London streets watching the delightful display of mannequins coming alive. Which they all obviously think is like animatronic or people like doing a little bit of a show for fun. And then they break through the glass and come out and begin to shoot with like weird wrist guns,
mm-hmm.
which is weird.
And some of the shoppers are Clive and his wife and kids.
Yes. And Clive gets shot.
Yeah.
That's like, how do they have wrist guns? How does that happen?
I guess they upgraded from when Mickey had paddles.
Yeah, that doesn't seem fair. But in any case, they're wreaking havoc and her mother is out there because she tried to call in Warner, but she's not hearing her. And they are watching this, like they're clearly looking like they're going to just throw the doctor like over into the magma.
Mm-hmm.
Is that their plan? Because the magma's like a person.
I don't know what their real plan was. Because they're okay. Holding him and he's fighting them. But it seems like, yeah, they're going to throw him into this fiery pit, except the fiery pit is the consciousness. Unless they want to absorb his consciousness, too.
Maybe. Interesting. This is when Rose decides that she's going to do something because her boyfriend wants to just leave, which is understandable because he doesn't understand what the fuck is happening. And this dude seems to be the root of all of their problems. And she runs over and gets a chain. And I'm not exact, like, because it's supposed to be that she, like, saves him here.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm not really seeing that. In the, like, she grabs the chain and she says something about how she had some like under 7 gymnastics training and she just got the swoops by on this chain.
Mm-hmm.
And somehow just her swooping by is an, I guess maybe it distracts.
Well, she knocks the mannequins. One of them into. She knocks one and it knocks the antiplastic out of his hand or whatever, and it falls into the fiery pit and becomes absorbed. So it starts to deactivate.
So
it
ends everything.
Yeah. So I guess she like kicked it and it luckily let go of the antiplastic.
Okay. So that's because really what I was, how I was looking at this was wrong then, because I was looking at it as how did she save the doctor? But really, it's just that she didn't, like, saving him was a circumstantial. The real thing that she did was, like, solve the plastic problem, which was, I don't think, her intention, really. Because I don't think she understood how that worked, that stuff.
She knew that it was anti-plastic and he planned on using it against them.
But she wouldn't necessarily know that, like, you know... Just throwing it into this thing would just end everything.
No, maybe she assumed. I like that she takes initiative.
Yeah, I'm like, I have no problem with that. It's just like the way that it's done is so sort of haphazard.
Yeah.
Like it's really a lot of accidental stuff
And I don't know of any gymnastics competition that requires you to swing on a rope.
Yeah, that was the other thing. It's like, she's like, oh, gymnastics. And then she just swing. I was expecting her to do a flip or something.
Yeah.
And instead she just like swings by like she's Miley Cyrus. And that apparently fixes everything. And that was really the main thing to me, was that it was all like, it was a lot of accidents. She knocks one guy over and he has the antiplastic and he falls in the thing. And that apparently serves as enough of a distraction that the doctor is able to like lift the other one up over his back and throw him in as well.
Mm-hmm.
When previously he had been completely powerless. So it's fine. It was just a little bit. Yeah. All right. But
yeah, there's some things you have to accept because it's this kind of campy show.
Right. So her mother had just been about to get shot to death by a bunch of mannequin brides.
The with, only ones with actual hair on their heads, little wigs.
Are they the only ones? That's interesting.
Yeah, all the other ones were bald, or they were male mannequins whose hair was already molded.
Right. Interesting. I wonder if there's significance to that. But they like look pretty awesome, to be honest. These three mannequin brides, they look like something that you would see if it was illustrated really creepily in like Scary Stories. Remember that book?
Mm-hmm.
But then once everything is done and they get into the TARDIS and move on to another spot, her boyfriend jumps out of it and like runs off to the side of amongst some pallets and simply cowers there.
Yeah.
He is really not doing well.
Not a good look for Mickey.
No. Literally clinging to her leg like a baby monkey that's clinging to his mom as she's like trying to climb up, and he's just like, I don't know how to climb yet, mom. And he is really like, the only thing that he has to say for himself is that she shouldn't go.
Yeah, because he's an alien.
He's a thing.
He's a thing, yeah. It's not a good look for Mickey.
And then he, like, he's clinging to her leg, and then he gets up on his knees and clings around her hips. Like, he really looks like a toddler.
He's had a trauma.
It's a bad, yeah, you're right, it's a bad look. She tells the doctor that she's going to stay here, and he looks disappointed and closes the door. Weird TARDIS sound. I like that the subtitles say TARDIS whooshing. And it disappears, and she's in the middle of like trying to deal with Mickey and his meltdown here. And obviously, standing there not really sure that she made the right decision. And then the sound begins again as Mickey stands there with his mouth open, just staring at the spot where the TARDIS was and can barely even move. And it comes back. And she turns to Mickey and says, thank you. And he says, for what? And she says, exactly. And then she just leaves.
Yep.
Is that basically, yeah, you didn't do shit. Is that what she's saying here?
Or maybe that he regularly doesn't do shit. That she can go off and have adventures and he's not enough reason to stay. I don't know. She did have to save his ass, though.
I mean, she definitely did. I just don't feel like, if having to save his ass is enough to warrant just being like, all right, I'm out. I'm going on magical adventures. Bye. Then that seems kind of unfair. Sometimes people need to be saved. I don't blame this dude for not coping well with being turned into a mannequin copy.
They've sort of peppered through the whole episode that it seems like Rose doesn't have a lot of prospects. That she says something about dropping out of school and how that, for some guy, and that didn't work out so well for her, and she's, you know, mm-hmm. considering going and taking her A-levels, and her mom keeps giving her ideas of jobs she can get now that are all, you know, being a shop girl. And then here's this adventure right at her feet. And that just seems more of a
use that, of the time. Like, but that's not addressing her saying exactly to him in this moment. Like, that's the part that I'm kind of like, what does that mean? Because it felt really snarky in a way that seemed super unnecessary at that moment.
Yeah.
This dude, like, he just went through some shit. Just like she did. You know, he got eaten by a garbage can and then held hostage by talking plastic lava. Surrounded by threatening dummies. And she's over here just being like, oh, God, what a baby.
Well, he was acting like a baby, so...
That's true, but I'm saying maybe...
I know.
Just...
When I first saw this episode, my opinion of Mickey was not good.
Okay.
Because he just seemed to be against everything that she was doing, and I'm a sucker for... No, I'm supposed to be on this person's side. Especially when it first starts, unless it's the Skylar White factor, which I have argued with people forever about. Team Skylar.
Same.
But in this, it was obviously Rose is the one we want to go on these adventures with the Doctor, and it felt like Mickey was holding her back.
But like, what did he hold her back from? The only time that he shows any resistance is when she's like, I'm going to go to the stranger's house who's a conspiracy nut and go talk. And like, that seems like a very reasonable stance to take. He doesn't follow her in. He doesn't menace the guy. He's like, no, I'm just going to come with you and I'll sit outside and he can know I'm there and that I'm watching and that he better not try some shit.
Yeah, I don't know, because rewatching it, even with the, you know, future having seen the whole series and whatever, like rewatching this episode with sort of a clear mind, I liked Mickey throughout the whole thing, except for when he's cowering like a baby.
Yeah.
Like otherwise,
when I thought that he was dead, I was just kind of like, oh, damn, I sort of like that guy.
Yeah.
So then when she ditches him like this, I was like, oh,
I don't know. It would have been better off if they, instead of having this scene, just have her like bring Mickey back to his house and then hear the TARDIS and run back outside than to be like completely dismissive of him.
Yeah. Because she's like, I saved you, but you can find your own way home. Like, she's not even, does he even have any like 50p for the bus to get home?
I think they're right outside their apartment building. I think he lives in the same building. Oh, okay. But
gotcha.
Considering that she spent all this time sort of mad at the Doctor or upset at the Doctor because he was so dismissive of Mickey's well-being, it seems a little strange that she's like, all right, see ya. You've done nothing for me.
Yeah.
So yeah, I agree.
Which, like, maybe he hasn't, but I don't feel like the episode really established that very well. Like,
no, they seemed cute early on.
Yeah, they did. Like, they seemed like they were having, like, we see them having lunch on her lunch break and she's laughing and having a grand time.
And even after her whole experience with her job blowing up, he's playful and she, like, trips him as he walks by her and laughs and like their relationship seems really cute.
When he answers the door when she comes to use his computer and he's like, oh, girlfriend's here, all right, kit off.
Yeah.
And then, can I use your computer? Oh, straight to the bedroom. Yes. Like, there's these little jokes that I just found very charming.
And he's like, don't check my emails. Which makes me wonder,
did I clear my browser history? Oh my god. Oh no. So yeah, I think that if like her decision to go with the Doctor like makes a lot of sense personally, but they put it in this context in this moment of it being like in relation to her relationship with him.
Yeah.
And it just it didn't really work for me because the two of them seemed super adorable together, I thought.
Yeah.
If that was her boss standing there and she was like, "Oh, bye." And it was like a Office Space sort of moment. Here's your pieces of flair. Then I would be like, all right, this all makes a ton of sense. But, yeah, I'm just curious what he's, like, going to tell everybody about his girlfriend and what she's going to say to her mom. Does she, like, go home at night after adventuring in the TARDIS during the day?
That would be a spoiler. Is this, like, a
day job? Yeah, it's true.
I'm not allowed to tell you those.
Just, does this come? Oh, great. At least tell me, does this come with medical and dental and a 401k? Because I feel like that's at minimum what she should be requesting here. This is pretty dangerous work.
Well, it comes with someone who would probably do everything to save her life.
That's what all bosses say. Then you get the flu and they're just like,
well, you should probably still come in. I know it's snowing, but it's not that bad.
Oh, God. Whatever. I've had that argument every time it snows bad enough here that it's dangerous to drive to work.
Yep.
The district manager always expects us to go to work. And I'm like, you're not going to work. Why do I have to drive on unsafe roads?
Yep. And then you go, you slave to come in, and you get like four customers. Because nobody in their right fucking mind is leaving their house today.
Oh, I don't think you understand people in their Starbucks, Natasha.
Ah, that's fair.
People will leave their house to go get Starbucks instead of make their own coffee.
I don't get it.
When there are icy roads.
Like, don't get me wrong. I love me some Starbucks. I'm a Starbucks fan. But, like, no. No.
There have been two times since I've lived here that we've had significant snow and ice where we needed to either stay closed or open late. And the one day that I went in where we were opening late, we had people knocking on the door while we were like trying to get ready to open. And I'd have to go to the door and tell them, sorry, obviously we came in late because of the weather. So it's going to be about a half an hour before we can open. We have to brew all the coffee and get everything set up. And people were mad about it.
Mm-hmm.
Like, go home and make your own damn coffee.
I remember seeing a thing about somebody who was, there was only one entrance and exit from the building. And so they had the front door open, but it said we're closed. And there was like one of those folding signs like in front of the door.
Mm-hmm.
And somebody moved it all out of the way and opened the door to come in. And they were like, we're not open yet. And they said, why is the door open? Well, we have to keep it unlocked if there are people in the building. Well, there's nobody in the building. The employees count as people, sir.
God.
And they were like, that's ridiculous. And then just stalked out. And I'm like, yeah, that seems right.
Yeah, I could tell some stories about some crazy things that customers have done, as I'm sure you could too.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, if you've worked in the service industry, everybody's got one.
Yeah.
Everybody's. My personal favorite is the lady who would always come in looking for the same item. And if we didn't have it, she decided that it was because somebody who was watching her and knew that she wanted it, and they came and took it before her on purpose.
Oh my God.
And it was really tough to deal with. Like, I'm not making fun of a mental illness at all, but it was really like, how do you cope with somebody? That's not your job.
Yeah.
You know? And you have to stand there and convince this woman that you're not part of it. Cause that was what she would start to think, that like we were covering.
Wow.
Yeah. So yeah, it was a rough one.
I had a guy come in a couple weeks ago with a coffee cup from a gas station, and he's like, I want to get a refill. And I was like, that's great, that cup's not from Starbucks.
Oh my God.
And he's like, yeah, but you guys give refills. And I was like, we do, of Starbucks. Like,
that's why it's called a refill.
Yeah, you know, like, you have to buy a coffee here and then you can get a refill while you're still here, but if you leave, it's no longer a refill, you have left. And we never give refills on QT coffee.
Oh my God.
And he argued with me. I was like, look, I'm gonna give it to you this time, but just
know, Jaime, no.
I needed to get him out. And my boss was standing right there, and she's like, hi, I'm the store manager. And she's right, we don't give refills on other people's coffee. But
that doesn't count as a refill. I know. That's just a fill.
I know. Well, people seem to not understand that if you buy your coffee and you leave and go home, and then you come back in the afternoon, it's not considered a refill. Just because you still have the cup.
Oh, people.
Yeah. Refills are free if you're like a rewards member, or 54 cents if you're not. If you can't afford your coffee refill, you probably shouldn't be coming to Starbucks.
That's true. That's true.
Anyway.
Mm. Anyway.
I would like to ask you what your first impressions of Rose and the doctor were.
Well, like I said, the doctor's kind of a dick.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a tiny bit into that. And Rose, other than this weird reaction to her boyfriend at the end, I really liked. She seems to have some common sense. And also Billie Piper is super pretty. Mm-hmm. So I kept getting distracted and was just like, good Lord.
Her hair looks great in the whole, like, end sequences.
Like, that's the other change, is that I, when I first watched this, thought she was so odd looking. And she is a little odd looking. Mm-hmm. Like, she has a very distinctive face.
She has very big features.
Yeah. And a very, like, square jaw. Mm-hmm. But, yeah, I really wonder how they're going to get along, because it doesn't seem like she really liked him, and yet she's going to go. Mm-hmm. So I wonder if they're going to actually get along.
Did you watch the little trailer that's attached to the end for the next episode?
No.
No? Okay.
Yeah, I try to avoid those.
It pops up so fast.
Yeah, that would happen with fucking Orphan Black, too, and it would drive me bananas. At least this, it, like, will completely fade to black, and then it will pause for a minute and start, mm-hmm. but, like, Orphan Black, it would just jump right into it, and it was... I got spoiled a couple times.
Were you watching that on Amazon, too?
Mm-hmm.
It must be an Amazon thing.
Yeah. So... Yeah. I haven't got too much of an impression on either of them yet. Not too much. But kind of a dick and seems to have good common sense are what I'm going to go with for my base features for each of them.
Is it enough for you to be intrigued for the next episode?
Yeah. Yeah, it is. Okay. Like I said, I kind of want her to, like, push back on him a little bit. That's part of my intrigue, is just like, well, somebody needs to occasionally put this guy in his place. So if anybody's going to do it, it seems like she'd be capable of that.
Yeah. Well, cool. I'm glad you liked it.
Yeah, me too. Because I was worried. Like I said, I had watched this before and I knew I had hated it. So I went into it and I was just like, well, all right, let's see. And it's just been very different this time around. So that's good. All right, do you want to plug anything, ma'am, before we wrap up?
I always need to plug my other show on the UNspoiled Network. It's called The Constant. It's about Lost. We are almost done with season 5, and then we will be starting season 6, which is the last season.
Oh, man. Here it comes. Guys, yeah. I'm definitely going to have to be listening to hear everything that's going on at this point. Although there's so much that you guys will post when you post a new episode that I've forgotten even happened in the show. I'm just like, oh yeah, that. So hopefully I'll be able to keep up.
I love, like, the crazier the show gets, like, the more absurd it is, the more I'm like, yeah, this show is so good. So I'm really happy that Krista is also enjoying it. Because I was nervous early on, like, what if she ends up hating it at the same point a lot of people started hating it? But all of the crazy, like, time travel stuff, she's just eating it up. She loves that. So
yay. Yeah. Nice.
It's really fun. So give us a listen.
Yeah, guys, definitely do. And if you're interested in other UNspoiled shows, like Harry Potter, which is the big one probably at this point. Also doing Dresden Files, which has been super popular.
Yeah.
And just wrapped on Dark Tower and Orphan Black as well. Starting Black Mirror for patrons only with Miles, which I just recorded yesterday. There is just a lot happening. There's a lot. And I'm also doing a lot of Spoil Me episodes, which are commissioned. People pay like $25 for me to read 50 pages of a book or watch one episode of a show and then talk about it. And those are solo, but those have been blowing up.
Yeah.
So
I really have concern for you. Like, when do you have time to sleep?
It's tricky. That's part of why I don't have because people have complained a couple times that they're like, you don't have a lot of availability on your Calendly for when, and I'm like, no, I don't.
Well,
how about that?
I was thinking about it because I was prepping for this show and prepping for Lost. And I was thinking about that thing you said where somebody like thought that you were charging too much. And I was mm-hmm. telling Jason about it and he was like, she's not charging enough. She spends a lot of time. Like, you have to read and watch stuff and maybe watch it a second time. Like, I know how
I try to watch everything twice.
I know how much time I put into just these shows, and it's a lot more work than people think. So your ask is not bad.
Yeah, I like, there are some higher tiered ones that you can pay more for, but they do take more time on my part as well. So it probably doesn't really wind up evening out. On the plus side, all the listeners who've commissioned stuff so far have excellent taste. So I've been really enjoying everything that I'm covering.
That's good. I was worried about that.
Yeah. So. I am also, like, it's inevitable. Somebody's going to pick something terrible at some point, and I'm going to have to be like, listen, don't do this to me. But so far, I just, like, actually finished two complete books. People commissioned all, like, enough that I was able to cover the entire book. So I wrapped on So You Want to Be a Wizard, which is really good, and I definitely cried like a baby during the recording of the finale. It was very emotional. That's the thing with the Spoil Me episodes. The books people are picking tend to be more emotional than a lot of what I've covered before. And I have wound up crying on like four of them so far.
Yeah, I heard or I saw your post about crying because of a Veronica Mars episode too.
Yeah, Veronica Mars. I don't think I cried on camera.
You didn't.
But I definitely cried while I was watching it. So You Want to Be a Wizard, I cried on camera. And I definitely cried on camera for multiple episodes of Fire and Hemlock by Diana Wynne Jones, which is super good. That's probably been my favorite so far to cover. And I'm not done with that one yet, but I think I will be because the person who's been commissioning those has been pretty steady. So yeah, just check it out. The Spoil Me feed is on iTunes. And if you're interested in commissioning something for me to check out, go to unspoiledpodcast.com/shop. You can also support the show at unspoiledpodcast.com/merch or /Amazon to use our Amazon link. Merch has a bunch of fun little things relating to other shows, quotes and illustrations and things, and on shirts and stickers and whatnot. And you can go and find us on Facebook at facebook.com/unspoiledpod, on Twitter at unspoiledshow, and on Instagram at unspoiledpodcast. And yeah, that's about everything. Is there anything you want to add, ma'am?
I don't think so. I think we've covered everything really well, probably more than it needed to be.
Indeed. That's the way of the unspoiled world. Analyze everything to death until all joy has been beaten from it. I'm just kidding. That's not really true.
It's not
true. It creates joy.
It does. It creates joy. You find little things that you love about something that you didn't even think about the first time you saw it or read it.
It's true. Yeah. When I say analyze something until there's no joy left, that's me. That's personally just how I work. It's not how the show works. All right, everybody. Well, thank you so much for listening. Thank you, Jaime, for taking on this enormous project with me. And we will see you next week with a new episode. Toodaloo, motherfuckers.
Bye.
Was an Unspoiled Network podcast.